हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। कृष्णा कृष्णा हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे हरे कृष्ण हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। Sing.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare राम हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे। हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे
Krishna, Krishna, Krishna.
Jaya Jaya Gopala Jaya
ಜ್ಞಾನತಿಮಿರಂಧಸ್ಯ ಜ್ಞಾನಾಂಜನಶಲಾಕಯಾ ಚಕ್ಷುರುನ್ಮೀಲಿತಂ ಯೇನ ತಸ್ಮೈ ಶ್ರೀಗುರವೇ ನಮಃ. ಶ್ರೀಚೈತನ್ಯಮನೋಭೀಷ್ಟಂ ಸ್ಥಾಪಿತಂ ಯೇನ ಭೂತಲೆ ಸ್ವಯಂ ರೂಪ ಕದಾ ಮಹ್ಯಂ ದದಾತಿ ಸ್ವಪದಾಂತಿಕಂ. ವಂದೇಹಂ ಶ್ರೀಗುರೋಃ ಶ್ರೀಯುತಾಪದಕಮಲಂ ಶ್ರೀಗುರೂನ್ ವೈಷ್ಣವಾಂಶ್ಚ ಶ್ರೀರೂಪಂ ಸಾಗ್ರಜಾತಂ ಸಹಗಣರಘುನಾಥಾನ್ವಿತಂ ತಂ ಸಜೀವಂ ಸಾದ್ವೈತಂ ಸಾವಧೂತಂ ಪರಿಜನಾಸಹಿತಂ ಕೃಷ್ಣಚೈತನ್ಯದೇವಂ ಶ್ರೀರಾಧಾಕೃಷ್ಣಪಾದಾನ್ ಸಹಗಣಲಲಿತಾ ಶ್ರೀವಿಶಾಖಾನ್ವಿತಾಂಶ್ಚ. ನಮೋಂ ವಿಷ್ಣುಪಾದಾಯ ಕೃಷ್ಣಪ್ರೇಷ್ಠಾಯ ಭೂತಲೆ ಶ್ರೀಮತೆ ಭಕ್ತಿವೇದಾಂತಸ್ವಾಮಿನಿತಿ ನಾಮಿನೇ. ನಮಸ್ತೆ ಸಾರಸ್ವತೇ ದೇವೇ ಗೌರವಾಣಿ ಪ್ರಚಾರಿಣೇ ನಿರ್ವಿಶೇಷ ಶೂನ್ಯವಾದಿ ಪಾಶ್ಚಾತ್ಯ ದೇಶ ತಾರಿಣೇ. ನಮೋ ಮಹಾವದನ್ಯಾಯ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಪ್ರೇಮ ಪ್ರದಾಯತೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣಾಯ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ನಾಮ್ನೇ ಗೌರತ್ವಿಷೇ ನಮಃ. ಹೇ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಕರುಣಾ ಸಿಂಧೋ ದೀನಬಂಧೋ ಜಗತ್ಪತೆ ಗೋಪೇಶ ಗೋಪಿಕಾ ಕಾಂತ ರಾಧಾ ಕಾಂತ ನಮಸ್ತುತೆ. ತಪ್ತ ಕಾಂಚನ ಗೌರಾಂಗೀ ರಾಧೇ ವೃಂದಾವನೇಶ್ವರಿ ವೃಷಭಾನುಸುತೆ ದೇವಿ ಪ್ರಣಮಾಮಿ ಹರಿ ಪ್ರಿಯೇ. ವಾಂಚಾಕಲ್ಪತರುಭ್ಯಶ್ಚ ಕೃಪಾಸಿಂಧುಭ್ಯ ಏವ ಚ ಪತಿತಾನಾಂ ಪಾವನೇಭ್ಯೋ ವೈಷ್ಣವೇಭ್ಯೋ ನಮೋ ನಮಃ. ಜಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ಪ್ರಭು ನಿತ್ಯಾನಂದ ಶ್ರೀ ಅದ್ವೈತ ಗದಾಧಾರ ಶ್ರೀವಾಸಾದಿ ಗೌರಭಕ್ತವೃಂದ. ಹರೇ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೇ ಹರೇ, ಹರೇ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೇ ಹರೇ. ಓಂ ನಮೋ ಭಗವತೆ ವಾಸುದೇವಾಯ, ಓಂ ನಮೋ ಭಗವತೆ ವಾಸುದೇವಾಯ. ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये नष्टप्रायेष्वभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवतसेवया भगवत्युत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवती नैष्टिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नन्दनाय च नन्दगोपकुमाराय गोविन्दाय नमो नमः। सो वी वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू। टुडे द टाइमिंग वाज चेंज्ड फॉर कृष्ण सायनम बिकॉज ऑफ द व्यास पूजा फेस्टिवल ऑफ परमपूज्य गोपालकृष्ण महाराज। टुडे there is also a parallel Purushottam Prabhu's very great, I think, Kirtan Mela is going to go on. So we were wondering whether to continue today's session or not. Then I told them, those who are attending English can get to hear the Kirtan after 6. Those who are attending Hindi can get to attend before 6. That way 4 to 8, both the groups will not miss. Then we proceeded to have this session today. So as you see here, these are some of the cross-sections of the pastime we will be discussing. But generally, I never begin Krishna Rasayanam without speaking about its relevance to our lives. Whenever I began Chitraketu or any pastime for that matter. So I will speak a few minutes. This pastime is very important for sadhana bhaktas. This pastime of Amrita Mahotsav, of producing Amrit by the churning of the milk ocean. Because our acharyas have compared, generating this Amritam from the milk ocean is very similar to awakening Krishna Prem in our hearts. So that means Amrit is compared to Krishna Prem. And just as you all know this pastime, you heard before, during the churning of the milk ocean, halahal came out. That is a stage of anartha nivritti. So a devotee has to tackle anartha nivritti very carefully, otherwise the halahal may cause someone to die. So who can help us completely remove the anarthas in our heart? Therefore Lord Shiva comes. Lord Shiva is called as the Charachara Guru. Charachara Guru means the Guru of the universe. He is also called as Loka Guruna, Loka Guru. He is called as Muninam Gurum, Charachara Gurum. Which means Shiva is actually a spiritual master of the whole universe. Parama Vaishnava. Vaishnavanam Yathashambhu. So our spiritual master represents also Shiva, our Guru. So he removes our halahal from our hearts. And before the halahal comes, many, many gifts came out of the milk ocean. Similarly, there is something called as bhaktiyuta, which means there is aparadotta, bhaktiyuta, sukrutotta, dushkrutotta. There are four types of things mentioned which have to be cleansed in order to undergo anartha nivritti. Everybody knows that if you do punya, you'll go to heaven and come back. If you do pap, you go to hell and come back. But from bhakti, how can any anarthas rise? Can there be anarthas from bhakti also? He says yes. Because when we do devotional service, the jiva becomes very beautiful. Because he develops detachment from material enjoyment. He becomes pious, he gets all good qualities. Then the bhakti attracts others to come towards the devotee and offer many gifts to the devotee. Many people give money, many people become followers, many people give gifts, and he gets post, he gets position, he gets name, fame, glory, many things. So these are all called as tarangarangini, they are called. Tarangarangini actually means before we attain Shuddha Bhakti, before the halahal is removed, there is a stage where when one does bhajana kriya, one gets many gifts which come. And there are people who will get swayed away by these gifts. If somebody, while pursuing bhakti, becomes attracted to a woman, then they go behind the woman, they go away. Or somebody becomes attracted to the popularity, fanfare, we call it, then they run behind the popularity. They go like this towards Krishna and then they go away like this. They get sidelined. It has happened to many people. Or somebody becomes attracted to money, or attracted to some unique position, respectable position. So in this way, the Tarangarangini deviates people. So therefore it is considered very dangerous. Some people have left the devotee association to become singularly popular, starting their own thing. It has happened with people. So therefore, the gifts which come before the halahal in the milk ocean, they represent those puja, labha, pratishtha and all those things which come in the life of a devotee. So you will see, even all of us, we are becoming devotees. Actually, a devotee saves money in two ways. One way is by not having sinful activities, you save money from spending for sin. Correct, no? You don't drink, you don't smoke, you have no illicit connection, you don't intoxicate, no smoking, no drugs. So because of avoiding the sinful activities, the money that people generally spend on these things, like watching, going to movies, going to party, how much money they spend, isn't it? So that money is saved. And then after spending that much money, they get sufferings which come, and diseases come. Then they go to the doctor and spend the second installment of money. That money is also saved for us. So we save double money. Imagine somebody is earning 50,000, they spend in sinful activities 20,000, another 20,000 for going to doctor. So you save 40,000 per month, you can imagine. Following these four regs. So by becoming devotee, the devotee becomes very beautiful because devotee has no bad habits. While the materialists are drinking liquor, devotee drinks milk. Materialists are eating all kinds of flesh and blood. Devotee is eating only sattvic ahar, the two offered to Krishna first. So the devotee's heart becomes purified by the sanctified prasad. So the prasadam is a food which is sanctioned and sanctified, both. It is sanctioned food only we eat, which is vegetarian. And sanctified food means by Krishna touch, it becomes sanctified, pure and holy. So because devotees consume pure items and they refrain from sinful activities and they deal with all living beings respectfully and they don't create any enmity with anybody and they pray for the goodwill of all the living beings, the devotees are always bright and bright-faced and cheerful and peaceful and blissful. So one professor noticed this in America. He told Prabhupada, Swamiji, how is it that your boys and girls coming to your moment are look so bright-faced? When they are chanting and dancing in the street, they are always happy and cheerful. You know, we are producing a class of hippies and you are making them happies. So, Prabhupada used to quote that in his lectures. That professor noticed that. So, in this way, that is another thing that is coming in this pastime. Therefore, this whole pastime is like our sadhana bhakti. His Holiness Kadambakanand Maharaj was once telling a story very relevant to sadhana bhaktas. So he was telling, once upon a time, the people were all lying in one place, sleeping. So one man came with a big basket full of varieties of fruits. Sometimes you see in the Hathgadi also, hand cart, you find some freshly cut pineapple slices or papaya, sometimes cucumber, sometimes different salads also, especially fruits. So all the fruits are available. He said, similarly, this fellow brought a basket full of varieties of fruits. So he woke up the sleeping people and he asked them, which one you like? Oh, somebody said, oh, I like pineapple one. He took some slices. Somebody said, oh, I like mango very much. He took some mangoes. Somebody said, I am fond of grapes. I am fond of plums. I am fond of apple. So they all picked up some bunch of pieces of those fruits. Whichever one they asked, he gave. So they all accepted and they ate it. Then as soon as they put it in the mouth, they delighted in it. Then the sleeping fellows woke up, they sat down, then they got up. Then they asked this man, can you give us more, second serving? The man said, if you want more, you have to follow me, you have to come with me. So as he walked ahead, good number of these people also got up. And some fellows were very lazy. They were just lying down. They said, if you want to bring, you bring it. Otherwise, I am not enthusiastic to get up. They were still going back to sleep. And then as these people walked with him, after some distance of walking on the road, some of them got very tired and they asked, hey, how long we have to walk? The sun is pretty hot. You are going on and on. You said we have to go to some place, but which place is that? How far is it going to take? That fellow said, have faith in me. Be patient. And some fellows suddenly looked at, because it was like a deserted place. Desert. It was all sandy place. So they turned around and saw some oasis with some few coconut trees. Then they asked, is that the place from where you got the fruits? So the man said, no, that's not the place. Don't get diverted. Come with me. But some fellows, sure enough, they got diverted. They went to the oasis. So they said, we are too tired. We will just, drink some water in this oasis. And then we'll climb up the coconut tree and take some coconut water and coconut malai and all that. So they remained there only. They got stuck there. The problem with oasis is, after some time, the fruits get over. And it may not be enough for everybody. It's a small facility. If you want to drink little water, you can drink, but it is not a facility to remain permanently there. So the master, he went ahead and people followed him further. And some people got too tired. They said, oh, you just cheated us. We are going on for so long. So then they took a U-turn and they went back, some people. They went back to the same place where they were lying. And some people remained in oasis. And then others who persisted, who never gave up, they went ahead and ahead and ahead. At that time, the breezes started becoming very cooling breezes. And the sun also became very mild at that time. So they asked, what is this pleasant experience we are getting? He said, because you have been very patient in walking to the destination that I promised you, we are very close to that. And then he took them to a place where there was a tall wall. Nobody could go inside. There was a big gate. And only this master, he had the key. He opened the place and he told them all, go in. So everybody went in, all those fellows. There they found abundant mangoes and abundant pineapple and abundant, their oceanic proportion. You could eat as much mangoes as you want. And you never get dysentery also there. Similarly, pineapple, all other fruits also. There was an orchard of all these things. There were ponds, there were ducks and swans and lotuses and lilies. Bumblebees were humming. It was a very, very pleasant atmosphere. Very shady, nice place to live. So, he was telling the story to us. We heard. And then he asked us, what did you understand from the story of the fruits? The fellow who lended out some pieces of fruit. So, let us say how many of you can recollect from the beginning, I will ask you. What are those? Who is that fellow who came and was distributing the fruits? That is a spiritual master. Vaishnava, devotee. And what are the fruits that he is distributing? Those fruits are different devotional activities. Like some fruits are like, for example, some fruits are the kirtans. Some fruits are the classes. Some fruits are like the prasad. Like the mango fruit is like the prasad. Most favorite. Everybody likes it. Correct, no? So, all devotional activities give joy. Some people like dancing. Some like singing. Some like hearing lecture. Some like watching Hare Krishna movies. Some like only prasadam. So, like that, these are all different type of fruits that is distributing. Pineapple, apple. like the papaya, like the different fruits. So he was taking out and distributing. So after tasting some devotional items, what happens to us? Huh? Yeah, we like it. We like it and we want more and more of it, correct, no? And we ask, which is the place where people simply dance so beautifully like this? Where they sing, where they eat nice prasad like this forever, for all time to come. Huh? Then the master will tell you that for that you have to do, you know, you have to practice, you have to follow me. Then he was inviting them to follow. So you all have seen also when we started device course or something, some people attend the device course and drop out. That means they are the fellows who lie down. They don't get up only. They don't want to go ahead further. Some people go ahead, they stay for 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, and then they go back, take a U-turn. And those who continue for some more distance, and those who go to that oasis, you know what is oasis? That is heavenly planets. It's like heavenly planets. Tetam bhaktva svargalokam vishalam kshine punye martya lokam vishanti evam trayi dharma manu prapanna gatagatam kama kama alabhante. Krishna says, gata agatam, he's saying. They go to heaven and they come back, because heaven, you cannot enjoy punya forever there. So they are the ones who are in oasis for a while. When nothing is in oasis, then they'll go back to their original place where they came from. So some people continued. Still it was very hot and everything. And what is that place where they felt a very soothing feeling, cooling feeling? That is Brahma Jyoti. After they enter the Brahma Jyoti, you are very close to the spiritual world. And then the top, tall, big walls, you can't barge into spiritual sky, spiritual world. Guru has to open the gate to the spiritual world. He has to take us. So he opened the gate and took them in. And then there was unlimited oceanic happiness there. So in the same manner, in this pastime also, you will see that, any great thing you want to achieve in life, material or spiritual, you have to make effort. Without making endeavor, many people say, Prabhu, will I get mercy? Will I get blessings? Will I get guidance? Everything you will get, but we have to endeavor. See, if a lady is pregnant, she only has to beget the child. Correct, no? A man is doing a job in the office, even if it is a rainy day, he only has to go to office. A child is studying in a school, you know, the child wants to play all day, he has to go to school to get earn his degree or whatever. So you will see in the same manner, in the path of bhakti also, no pains, no gains. Don't make effort, we just don't grow. We don't take initiative, we are just stuck. There is one verse by Gajendra where he says, jijivishenahamihamuyakim antarbahischa vritayobayonya icchami kalena nayasya viplavas tasyatma loka varanasya moksham. In this verse he is telling, my dear Lord, the avaran or the ignorant covering over us, which is like darkness in our heart, that is not possible to be dissipated by just keeping quiet. For example, if a boy doesn't go to school for 10 years, he is going to remain ignoramus. He is just not going to develop any knowledge. So we can become stagnated in our spiritual life if we don't take initiative. Actually, we have to feel very strongly that something I am doing now, I have to do it differently. I cannot just go on doing like this. I am very unhappy. For example, if I am getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning and just taking a bath and running for Mangalarati, and I am not getting the early morning hours, half an hour, 1 hour, then I have to actually bring about a change. So if I am not feeling very bad about it, and if I am not protesting against it, if I am not seeking a reformation, then there is no possibility that we are going to change. If I am lazy, I will be lazy only, as it is. So Gajendra is saying, my dear Lord, millions of lifetimes may pass without me making any progress because the darkness in my heart remains as it is. You can shout at the darkness, or you can take a broomstick and try to remove the darkness. You cannot do that. There is only one way darkness can be dispelled, which is by switching on the light. And that light is Om Jnana Timirandasa Jnana Anjana Shalakaya. When Guru lights up the heart with knowledge, then the darkness will be driven out. Now one may ask, when will Guru light up my heart with knowledge, with full knowledge, so that I will become very enlightened? See, you will find, depending on the individual sincerity of the jiva, the Lord is ready to reciprocate. But the reciprocation is the second thing. The first thing is jiva's sincerity and endeavor. I'll tell you some examples, it'll become clear for you. There was one Vasudev leper in the same Kurumagram where Kuruma Brahman lived. So when Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came in the evening, Vasudev leper thought that I will meet the Lord in the morning, tomorrow morning. But then next day morning, Lord Chaitanya got up and very early morning he left. Then when Vasudev leper came to the house of Kuruma Brahman, Kuruma Brahman said, sorry, the Lord has left already. And he loudly cried, alas, alas, what a fool I am. The Supreme Lord came to our village and I did not get his darshan. Who can be more unfortunate than me? He cried so piteously, with so much sincerity. Wherever Lord Chaitanya was, far away traveling, in his heart he felt the pinch that my devotee is crying for me. So Lord took a U-turn and came back to Kurumagram again to give darshan to Vasudev leper, and he embraced him and removed his all the leprosy in his body and gave him a very handsome body, and also he blessed him to become a preacher and told him to chant the holy name. But the point is, what the Lord Chaitanya's reciprocation came, but after the piteous cry of Vasudev leper, his sincerity. In the same manner, Lord says, even if you are an illiterate, you don't know how to study the books left behind by your spiritual master. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Tesham evanakam partham ahamajnana jam tamaha nashayama atmabhavasto nashayami atmabhavasto jnana deepena bhasvata. He's saying, Arjuna, seated in the heart of my devotee, I will light up the devotee's heart with the torchlight of knowledge and eradicate the darkness if my devotee is very sincere. Like he says, Dadami Buddhi Yogam Tam. But to whom he gives Dadami Buddhi? Tesham Satata Yuktana Bhajatam Preeti Purvakam. Those who are always constantly engaged in one form of devotional service. Morning to night, we are busy with some type of devotional service. Either we are hearing, or we are speaking, or we are chanting, or we are decorating the Lord, or we are worshipping Him, or bowing down to Him. So some seva we are doing. So satatam, continuously. So in this way, by our sincere call or effort, either through chanting or praying or endeavor, then Lord becomes pleased, He reciprocates. Therefore He says, Gajendra says, right now I am an animal body, I am very ignorant, He says. We can see, although we are all in a human body, sometimes the human body also is taken over by the tamaguna. So then we become very lethargic, very dull, very spiritually very ignorant or ignoramus. Then we can offer similar prayers like Gajendra. Then by offering such a prayer, we have taken the initiative, then the Lord will reciprocate. He will give us the good intelligence to approach Him. So the initiative has to be taken by the individual. In this pastime, you will see the asuras and devatas, both are taking initiative by declaring a truce. And this is a very, very interesting pastime, because many of us in our own lives, every one of us sitting here, we might have had some quarrel, some displeasure, some enmity, some friction, some some sparks might have come out with somebody in this world. Do you all agree? Can anybody sitting here say that, Prabhu, in my life, I never had a strain in relation with any jiva in this world? With everybody fell in love with me, I fell in love with them. Is it possible to say that? So you will see, therefore, we all find difficulty oftentimes with very people with whom we work very close. It could be husband or wife or children or parents or grandparents or uncle or aunt or brothers, sisters. We can face challenges, our colleagues in the office. The problem becomes more and more, especially with those we work very closely, because over the years our expectations increases more and more from others. And when expectations are not met, we become frustrated and become angry. So here in this pastime, as you see here, the Devadas and Asuras are the people who are like sworn enemies. They are perpetual enemies. Why? Devata means Vishnu Bhakta Smrito Daiva, and Asura means Asuras Tat Viparyayaha. Asuras are opposed to Vishnu, and Devatas are for Vishnu, pro Vishnu. And when Devatas actually maintain the cow, drink the milk of the cow, you know, take the ghee of the cow for doing yajna and everything, Asuras slit the throat of the cow. They just do the opposite. So, socially, if you see, Devatas and Asuras have big difference. Devatas are in sattva-guna, Asuras are in rajoguna-tamaguna. Just it doesn't match together. Like for example, if a sattva-guna person and tamaguna person put them in the same room, there'll be a lot of problem. Because tamaguna person is naturally unclean. He may go to pass water and not wash the feet. And he will spit everywhere, thoo here, thoo there, everywhere. In the railway station they put one thoo, you do 500 rupees. They put a fine now. So, on the other hand, sattva-guna person will find very difficult. It's like, you know, fire and water cannot coexist in one place. Darkness and sun cannot exist. Wherever the sun goes, darkness is driven out. So sattva and tamaguna cannot exist together. Just not possible. Similarly, asuras and devatas just cannot work together. It's just next to impossibility. You will see that. Similarly, a mild-tempered person, mild-natured person, and a hot-tempered person, very difficult to work together. A hot-tempered person is very aggressive, very straightforward. He speaks on the face, he's a little insensitive. He wants to get the thing done. And a mild-natured person is very timid, very soft-natured, he doesn't speak much. You have to understand his gestures and signs and what he's trying to say. So when these people are put together, there can be explosion in the relationship. But here you find, in this pastime, strangely enough, the Devatas and Asuras are working together. Very amazing pastime it is. Although they are in every respect, they are opposite. So this pastime teaches us a very great lesson. Even if you are poles apart with your friends or relatives, you still can work together if you keep Lord Vishnu in the center. That is one lesson we are learning. There have been families, husband, wife, who had almost gone to the verge of divorce. But some very good counselor came in between them and pacified both parties and told the husband and wife, see, these quarrels are like a passing phase in life. They come, they stay for a few months and they go away. But at that period of time, you have to control yourself, restrain yourself and focus on spiritual life so that when that phase goes away, again you become normal. So we should not become impulsive in our life. Impulsive means you are driven by emotions alone. Reason, you know, doesn't exist. So then what to do? Therefore it is said that emotions can impel you, but they cannot compel you. They can impel you means they may push you, but they cannot compel you to act in a certain way. Acting is in your hands only. So devatas and asuras naturally don't like each other. Their natures, their behaviors, their activities, everything is different. If you see Hiranyakashipu telling his asuric associates, you know, go and break the temples, he's telling, you know, break the bridges, cut down all the pious trees, he's telling. And also burn the hermitages of the brahmanas and saintly people. You know, cut the cows, kill the cows, like that he's telling. And devatas do just the opposite of all these things. The devatas protect the cows, they offer respects to the brahmanas. Brahmanas are the leaders of the society who teach Vedas to the people. They worship Lord Vishnu. They preserve the pious trees and they cut only babul trees or thorny trees. So you will find that their natures are opposite, but they cooperated together in this pastime. Which means in our life also, if you are beginning spiritual life, till the last breath, we should not look back. Nor should we get diverted. Sometimes a person comes to the point of initiation, After initiation, they lose the fuel after that. Till then, they were running fast. And after the initiation, they feel that, okay, now I got the ticket back to Godhead. Guru will take care. It's like Arjuna telling Krishna, Krishna, you are there. So you take care of the Kurukshetra battle and I am going to sleep. Imagine if Arjuna is sleeping in the chariot. What do you think Krishna will do? Actually, Krishna will give guidance, but who should fight? Arjuna should fight. Similarly, our Guru will give us guidance, but we have to take initiative in spiritual life to grow, to survive crisis, difficulties, challenges. We should not quit and go away. Because dangers will come. There are so many people who come and take very enthusiastically in the beginning. After some time, certain period of time, they find, oh, now it is very great challenge. I have some interpersonal clash with somebody. So they quit and go away. There are some people, they think, oh, it is so difficult. I have to do my profession. I have to take care of my family. I have to take care of Krishna consciousness. Everything is just making my head spin. Things are going crazy. You know, if I want to remain peaceful, I can't handle everything. So which is the easiest thing to give up? Because they don't want to give up the home and they don't want to give up the salary. The easiest thing to give up is going to temple. Then they stop going to temple. Give up Krishna consciousness very easily. So, first of all, we can't work with Asuric people, but here you find Asuras and Devatas work together. But when halahal comes, people may quit and go away. Similarly, when we see the anarthas coming out of the heart, blackish anarthas, one gets extremely discouraged and one may feel frightened. One may feel depressed and one may think, oh, spiritual life is very difficult. My heart is filled with so much anarthas. So, like anticlimax. I ran away. Some people run away from spiritual life. So, just like one boy in second year got 3 papers fail. And still he was allowed to go to third year. But he didn't pass these 3 papers. Next time he got 4 more papers. Now he got 7. But third year he spent all his time playing games, cricket and everything. And by the time he went to third year, of course he got a year down. So practically he had 10, 12 papers to complete. It became overwhelming. Similarly, if we don't take initiative in spiritual life and cleanse our heart and go ahead, then our anarthas will become so much that we'll get overwhelmed by not taking initiative, by not doing homework. So, for example, if a man comes to know from a doctor that he has got cancer, or he has got some deadly disease like that. And expenditure may be more, but still people spend, is it not? Time may have to be given. Still people give time. Some people have to actually downsize their business or something for the sake of cancer. Do they do or not? Yeah, they do that. Some people are able to remove the cancer cells in 2-3 years. If it is in the first or second stage, they are able to do that. So people, you know, reduce their business, reduce their job, and they reduce the other activities, and they put all the focus on what? Their health. Same thing we should do in spiritual life. In spiritual life is actually the health of the soul. Like we have health of the body, we have health of the soul also. For soul's health, one has to know how to do our material activities in such a way that the soul's health can be restored back. Like Prabhupada gave an example. If your finger has a wound, if there's a wound here, you are not able to bend it. So you are supposed to take a pen and put a signature. So the man wants to put a signature, but the finger is refusing to bend because of pain, because it's a diseased finger. So Prabhupada compared the diseased finger to a conditioned soul. He compared. Conditioned soul is unable to cooperate with Krishna to put a signature. Krishna wants to put a signature, we are not able to cooperate. So in the same manner, conditioned souls have disease. So instead of serving Krishna, they want to enjoy the material world. So that disease has to be cured. So for curing the disease, we have to take the medicine and we have to do the, you know, follow the process. So therefore, the devatas actually, you will see, they were willing to cooperate with even demoniac people. They were ready to stay and continue even though halahal came, even when the gifts came, they did not touch anything. At last, when amritam came, even at that stage, the demon snatched and went away. Prabhupada says the impersonal Brahman is the last snare of Maya. Prabhupada says. Sometimes a devotee may practice for many years, and due to frustration in the bhakti, he may go become a Buddhist, and he may become an impersonalist. So, like the amrita was taken away. But if one persists in the path of bhakti, then success is guaranteed for a rigid practitioner. Prabhupada says in one purport, success is guaranteed for a rigid practitioner, he says. So, a rigid practitioner means one who doesn't quit and run away. One who is patient, one who is persistent, one who is always hope, keeping hope after hope, called Ashabandha, we call it. So, now I will show you the overview of this chapter, and only selected sections we will go through this pastime. See, the rule of, coming here? Yeah. The chapter is entitled Demigod's Appeal to the Lord. There is a talk about Raivata Manu, who is the fifth Manu. Then the sixth Manu is Chakshusha Manu. So all that is going on. Now, Parikshit is asking him to continue. So here, see, this is a portion. So here the demigods are approaching Brahma. Yeah. See, due to Durvasa Muni's curse, the demigods lost in fight with the demons, and the three worlds became poverty stricken. See, in this world, Kala is a very powerful factor. Sometimes a billionaire becomes a beggar. Sometimes a beggar becomes a billionaire also in this world. So the demigods lost all their opulences because of disrespecting Brihaspati, their guru. Indra was carelessly sitting in his Simhasan along with his wife Sachi, you know, other demigods catching umbrella over his head, and all demigods showering flowers upon him, praising him with prayers and everything, thousands of them. So when the Guruji came in, Indra became careless and neglectful because of pride, temporarily, but quickly realized it. Then he searched for his guru. His guru was hiding so powerfully that even Indra couldn't search. See, Indra can go to any nook and corner of the universe. That much power Indra had. There is no place in this world where he cannot go. But even he still couldn't find Brihaspati. Can you imagine? After all, he is, Brihaspati is guru of Indra. He must have found out a place in the universe where Indra cannot access. Correct? No, he couldn't find him. At last, they all go to Brahma. Demigods are approaching Brahma and informed him about all the incidents. Seeing that the demons are flourishing, while demigods were in awkward position, Lord Brahma meditated on the Lord Vishnu. Now he is speaking to them. There are many prayers of Brahma to the Supreme Lord. He is saying, "Oh Lord, you are the origin of even Shiva, demigods, all of us." There are a lot of prayers like that. So Lord Brahma is taking demigods to the Shvetadvipa. So he's talking about the qualities of the Lord. Lord's omniscience. Lord is all-knowing. He knows about Kala. He knows why you guys have lost the opulence. Everything Lord knows. There's nothing that Lord doesn't know. In this way, there are many prayers here. But I want to show you one section. These are all... So, after this is the most important chapter. After that, prayers of Brahma are over. Now, Lord will speak to them. Please read this. Is it big enough?
Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, being worshipped by demigods, appeared before them with bodily effulgence resembling simultaneous rising of thousands of suns. Their vision being blocked, they could not see anything including Supreme Personality of Godhead.
You can see when Krishna appeared in the battlefield of Kurukshetra in his Vishwarupa Darshan, it was like 1,000 suns rising together. Can you imagine? Even one sun is so brilliant. Lord was like 1,000 suns shining. Yeah. Read this.
Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva saw the beauty of the Supreme Lord, blackish body resembling a Markata gem. Eyes are reddish like the depths of a lotus. Garments yellow like molten gold. Entire body is attractively decorated. Smiling lotus-like face crowned by a helmet bedecked with valuable jewels. Attractive eyebrows and his cheeks are adorned with earrings.
Belt See, what is waist, the cheeks adorned with earrings? Do you put earrings here? Why it is saying that earrings are here but they are shining on the cheeks? Yeah.
Belt on waist, bangles on arms, necklace on chest and ankle belts on legs. His neck is decorated with Kaustubha gem. He carries with him
Goddess of Fortune.
The Goddess of Fortune and his personal weapons. All the demigods immediately fell to the ground.
And what are his personal weapons? Shankh, Chakra, Gada, Padma. Yeah.
Fell to the ground offering their obeisances.
Yes. So in this way Lord gave them darshan mercifully. Then Brahma is offering prayers. So he's saying, my Lord, you are unborn but still you appear for the welfare of your devotees. So there are prayers of Brahma. So the Brahma is offering many prayers, but one or two prayers I will show you. What is he saying? Read this. Yeah.
Although creating and entering into this world, you are independent. This is perceived only by those who are advanced in Krishna consciousness, fully in knowledge of Shastra, and who are cleansed of all material contamination.
See, Goloka Nivasati, Akhilatma Bhuto. Lord is expanding as Mahavishnu, Garudaksha Vishnu, Kshiradaksha Vishnu, but he remains in his Goloka also. Yeah.
The pious affirm that by Bhakti Yoga one can achieve your favor even in this world. Analogy, fire from wood, milk from the milk bag of the cow, food grains and water from the land, prosperity from industrial enterprises.
This is what I was telling you. This shloka is very important. We will recite that shloka. There you can show 8612.
Yataagnimedasyamritam cha goshu bhuvyannamambudyamane cha vrittim yogairmanushya adiyanti hitvam guneshu buddhya kavayo vadanti.
See, this verse talks about taking initiative. Say you want to cook something in the kitchen, so you need firewood, correct? No, but the firewood doesn't have fire ready made. You have to light up and you have to fan it, otherwise smoke will come. Sometimes you take a long blower, you have to blow also to grow the fire. So it takes some trouble, correct? See, in a winter season, sometimes it is very cold. So people make a campfire, you have seen that? But to harness the fire, it takes some time. You have to put some firewood and lit it up. It takes maybe half an hour or something. Or you want hot water in the morning, even a boiler. In villages, they have a boiler, no, vertical one. You put some wood and coal and everything. It takes time. That means fire is present in wood, but to remove the fire from the wood, it takes some initiative you have to take. Similarly, somebody wants to drink a cup of milk, then you have to maintain a cow. Not only a cow, you have to milk the cow. Not only you have to milk the cow, you have to feed some grass. You have to take care of the cow also. So that means basically these examples are teaching us two things. That means material, spiritual, you want to do anything, you have to take initiative. That's one thing. Success if you want. And material, spiritual, in both there are headaches and troubles and difficulties that one should be anticipating, not only tolerating. One should be anticipate, be prepared. There will be challenges, difficulties will come if you want success. Similarly, the example of, like you say, one of you want to eat a mango, somebody gives you a mango seed. You may ask, hey, is this a mango? No, you have to sow the seed, water the seed, plant will come, then you can have thousands of mangoes after that. You have to take initiative. Therefore, you have heard that song. One song says, I asked God for a beautiful butterfly sitting in a flower. God gave me a caterpillar and a cactus. So both are ugly. You know, caterpillar looks ugly. Some people get allergic also seeing the movement of the caterpillar. But from the caterpillar came butterfly. From the cactus came a flower. Then the butterfly sat on the flower. So in the same manner, that song says many things like that. I asked God for this, God gave me this, like that it says. So the idea is, Lord wants the living beings to take initiative, make effort, and then He reciprocates with them. Otherwise, we will not be able to experience the joy of having received many gifts. If some gift comes to you in your life without an endeavor, what happens? What happens? It has no value, you take it for granted, and then you misuse it also. Correct, no? Nalakur Manigrib got so much money from their father Kubera, they misused it. Isn't it? You may misuse it. So all this example is giving. Yeah. Read this one.
This 13th
verse, we can recite that verse also. Very nice verse. Tam tvam bhayam nata samujjihanam sarojana bhati chirepsitartham drishtvagata nirvritam adya sarve gajadavarta ivagangamambaha. Translation.
Elephants afflicted by a forest fire become very happy when they get water from the Ganges. Similarly, O my Lord, from whose navel grows a lotus flower, since you have now appeared before us, we have become transcendentally happy. By seeing your Lordship, whom we have desired to see for a very long time, we have achieved our ultimate goal in life.
Yeah, so the elephants afflicted by forest fire are compared to all of us. So we are like the conditioned souls, we are suffering. So Lord Vishnu's darshan is like a cloud shower. When there is a shower from a rain cloud, then the elephants are dancing in ecstasy, because there is nothing in the forest which can put out the fire so powerfully like a very heavy rain shower. Because nobody can go with a fire brigade to forest. And even if you have a fire brigade, forest fire is so huge, it's not possible to put off. Similarly, the samsara, dava and alali loka, we say, the sufferings in our life cannot be mitigated by any other way other than taking shelter of the Lord. That's the meaning of this. See, in the next verse here you can see, they are saying, you know everything, Lord, and you not be informed. Please fulfill our purpose. That means what they are saying, we have come to you with a complaint, but we will not give you a complaint. Why? Because you know what is our situation. You are in the heart of everybody. See, this is a very important point. Very important point. See, the Lord's reciprocation is based on our sincerity. Like Mukunda, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, I will not give mercy to Mukunda for 10 million births, he said. And then Mukunda outside was so happy when Vaishnavas told him. He said, I will see the Lord after 10 million births. I will see. He was dancing. Then that attitude of Mukunda, which was so positive, attracted Lord Chaitanya's mercy immediately, instantly. Mahaprabhu called him inside. Please come in. Bring him in. The next moment, that means, you know, 10 million births were shrunk to only one moment because of his very positive attitude. So he didn't mind 10 million births. Some of you may have a question. Prabhuji, was he not little put off waiting for 10 million births? But what was his point, Mukunda? Lord did not outrightly reject me. At least he has kept some period, time period. He has kept some 10 million births. I don't mind, because that means there is a scope, there is a hope for me to see him, meet him. So therefore, the sincerity of Mukunda brought Mahaprabhu's mercy immediately. Same with that milk drinking brahmachari also. Mahaprabhu chastised him, who was hiding behind and watching Mahaprabhu's dancing in the kirtan in Srivasangan. Mahaprabhu asked everybody, is there anyone here who is not supposed to be here? Then all the Vaishnavas thought, maybe I myself only, they thought. Because I have so many material desires, I am a fallen soul. And then Srivastava Thakur came forward and said, my dear Lord, there is one milk drinking brahmachari, he is only a dugdahari. You know, he begged me repeatedly that he wanted to see your dance and singing. So I had allowed him permission to hide behind and watch. In case he doesn't have your permission, it's up to you, you can send him away. So call him here, Mahaprabhu said. When he came in the front, Mahaprabhu spoke very strongly. He said, do you think by austerities and penances and Vedic scholarship and all these things, anyone can attain the darshan of the Lord? So he said, bhakti is not available for anyone with, like Krishna says, naham vede na tapasa na dana na chaijaya, all those things. Mahaprabhu chastised him and said, get out. So when he got out, he was sitting outside, you know, contemplating on how fortunate I was. Although Mahaprabhu told me I am unqualified, still I got a glimpse of the kirtan and dance of Mahaprabhu. I am not a Vaishnava. I am a Vaishnava. Maybe I am very austere and drinking milk, but I have no bhakti. And maybe in some lifetime I will get bhakti and then Mahaprabhu will include me as one of his associates. When he thought like this, next moment, immediately Mahaprabhu told devotees, go and call that fellow. He instantly became Mahaprabhu's associate, next moment. So therefore, they are saying here, why have we come to you? Because Indra disrespected Brihaspati, Brihaspati became angry, and Brihaspati disappeared, and because he was upset and he disappeared, he was enraged. Due to this, Indra lost his opulences. Now along with Indra, we demigods, we also lost all our kingdom, our opulence, everything. Now we are beggars in the street. So, and we don't have to tell you this truth to you. Why? Because you are all knowing, you are omniscient, you are super soul in our hearts. What is there which you do not know? But we are, nevertheless, we are coming to you. Why? Because by praying to you, we stand to gain. You don't gain anything from us. We are like children, you are like a father. We gain a lot from you. By praying to you, our sinful reactions can be eradicated. By praying to you, the offenses will be mitigated and eventually destroyed. By praying to you, we may get promotion from earth to heaven, or we may become free from the birth and death, cycle of birth and death. By praying to you, if you become satisfied and pleased with us, you can give unlimited benedictions to us. Benediction can be small or big. Sudama got some kind of benediction of house and servants and everything. Somebody can get different benediction. Dhruva got a Dhruva Loka benediction. So by praying to you, we get benedictions. By praying to you, one can get moksha, liberation. By praying to you, one may even get entry into spiritual world and get one swarupa, and one may get a chance to see you face to face and serve you eternally. So like that, you know, you can see that therefore the demigod just presented themselves in front of the Lord. That's all. We are here, my Lord, you know what is best for us, you do for us. This is a very good prayer. In Prithu also, in the fourth canto, when Lord Vishnu asked Prithu, Prithu, I am so pleased with you. Please tell me what you want. Prithu thought for a while what to ask the Lord. Then he turned to Lord and said, my dear Lord, I don't want to ask you for anything. You give me what is best for me. For example, if you go to a crorepati and you tell him, sir, I have come for some donation to you. And he's asking you, how much you want? Is it good to tell the amount? Say, if you tell him, sir, 5,000 rupees, you say. He said, that's all. I thought of giving you 50 lakhs. You only wanted 5,000. So, then what you should tell a donor? How much you want if he asks you? Aapki marji. Whatever you wish to give. That's what is intelligence. So, that's what Prithu said, my dear Lord, if I ask you for something, it may be a foolish benediction. I may ask you for heaven or something, or I may ask for a handsome body or something, or wealth or something. Better, I will not ask you. I am like a naughty child. Naughty children, if you ask a child, hey, ask your mom anything you want, child will say, Mama, please give me a Cadbury. Because child is definitely going to ask things which are harmful for the teeth or whatever. But if the parents, they know what is good for the child. So he concluded in a verse, Prithu said, my dear Lord, you are like a father. Father will never do anything harmful to the child. Therefore, I leave it to you. You do what is good for me. And then he said, if you still ask me that I should propose your benediction, he said,
I have only one desire, he said. I want to massage your feet. Like Lakshmiji is massaging your feet in the Vaikuntha. Like that, he said. And then he said, I am only afraid if I come to Vaikuntha and massage one of your feet, Lakshmi may say, hey, I am already there, why are you coming here? Then I will tell Lakshmi that you take one feet, I will take one feet. We both will massage. And then he said, my dear Lord, I hope there will not be competition between me and Lakshmi. Although she is like my mother, she is a universal mother. In case there is a competition, I am sure that you will take my side, he said. Prithu, why? Because in the episode of Prithu and Indra episode, Prithu said, you took my side, which means you blessed me. And for Indra, you gave him, you know, the credit of having done 100 yajñas. But for me, you gave yourself. Therefore, when I come to Vaikuntha also, hopefully you will be on my side. So my desire is to massage your lotus feet, like that he said. So the idea is, when we go to pray to the Lord, we should be aware that Lord is very powerful. He is all-knowing. And He can actually not only alleviate our problem, He can give in such a way that we will be overwhelmed. So, what is the last thing I was saying? Well, Lord can overwhelm us. For example, say if you go to Lord to give Him something, how many hands you have? 2 hands. But if Lord wants to give you with His Vishwarupa Darshan hands, how many hands He has? Millions of hands. So can you catch what Lord gives you? You won't be able to catch. So therefore, Lord can give any great thing. Therefore, the demigods were intelligent. They told the Lord, you know everything. You need not be informed. You know our pathetic situation. Because you are lying in the milk ocean and simply twinkling your eye, you are activating Kala, time. And that time sometimes keeps demigods up, demons down. Sometimes it topples like this. Demons come up, demigods are down. So you are the person who is activating time. What is there which you do not know? You know everything. You are our Father. You are our Supreme Well-Wisher. So you do what is good for us. Please deliver us. That is suitable for Brahmanas and demigods, for all of us. Now the Lord is instructing demigods from 1625. The Lord is going to speak from here, in the 16th verse. In 16th verse it is said that the Lord spoke in a sweet voice, but a deep voice like which was resembling the rumbling of clouds. In other places it is said, Megha Gabhiraya Vacha. Here also it says similar word. Jagada Jimuta Gabhiraya. Gabhiraya Gira. Gira means words. Lord's words were very grave and very powerful. God is replying them. We will recite the 17th verse. Put the 17th verse.
Yeka yeveshwarastasmin surakarye sureshwarah vihartukamastanah samudron matanadibihi.
Although the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the master of the demigods, was capable of performing the activities of the demigods by himself, he wanted to enjoy pastimes in churning the ocean. Therefore, he spoke as follows.
See, Lord is very fond of utsavams, mahotsavams, and playful pastimes. Here is the word vihartum is used. Vihartukamaha means Lord wanted some enjoyment along with all his jivas, the demigods, through this pastime. So, samudron matanadibihi. He took part in this pastime of samudra mantan, it says. You see, in this world, you all know, we all do any activity to get some enjoyment out of it. Why do people play cricket? Or why do you play carom? Why do you play chess? You play games to get some happiness. Or why do people marry? Or why do people go to college? Why do people want to earn a degree? If you ask any question, the end result we want is happiness, enjoyment out of it, happiness. And is it wrong to seek enjoyment? Like we say, you know, don't do sense gratification. We tell quite often in our lectures. But the very nature of the soul is pleasure seeking, enjoyment seeking. Then how can you say, don't try to enjoy? Because like here you find, vihartu kamaha, the Lord Himself is seeking enjoyment, happiness. Being a jiva, we are part and parcel of the Lord, so we also seek enjoyment. Then what is the problem? Why do we say, don't try to enjoy this world? Actually, we should know, we should enjoy only through Krishna. Therefore, I told you, sanctioned and sanctified enjoyment. Like for example, if somebody takes the ocean water directly and drinks, that ocean water will increase your thirst. The more you drink ocean water, it's a salty water, saltish water. It increases your thirst more and more. But if you allow the ocean water to be evaporated by the sun, and then you take the water coming down from the clouds, that is potable water, drinking water. That will pacify you, satisfy you. So the sun is predominated by Surya Narayanan. The Surya Narayana is actually Lord Vishnu, who is giving the effulgence to the sun. Without his presence, there is no effulgence. So that means when the ocean water gives the water to Narayana, and then when Narayana sanctifies the water and gives it back, then we get it as rain water after that. Correct? You will see Bharat Maharaj offered a prayer from Rigveda to Surya during his Gayatri. That time he was addressing Lord Narayana while worshipping the sun. So now because the water is, salt water is sanctified and given purely, in the same manner while you are earning money from the company, that's like salt water. But you give a portion of it to the Lord, then what you have is sanctified. Sanctified money. Similarly, you make altar in your home, then you have a sanctified home. You eat the, first offer the food to the Lord in gratitude and thankfulness, then the rest of the food becomes sanctified food called prasadam. Correct, no? Similarly, you want to own a property, you know, therefore people see the vastu purusha and people own a property, it is allowed. But one should not usurp another's property, like what Duryodhana and all the Kauravas did. They were usurping another's property. That becomes outside our quota. So quota means whatever God has allotted for you as a property. Similarly, one is allowed to marry, but one should have a religious marriage and beget children to raise in Krishna consciousness. One shouldn't go outside the marriage for extramarital affair. Then it becomes sinful. So in this way, in everything the quota is prescribed by the Lord. Like for example, in ISKCON we have a rule. Any money comes, we first put it in accounts department. And then you give a challan, voucher, to take out money from the accounts. Say for example, I have, you know, I am getting 20,000 rupees. If I put the money and tomorrow I want 5,000, I will take out. Somebody may say, Prabhu, why to put there and take out? Just keep it with you in your cupboard only, just keep spending. Is it all right? Therefore, I told the example, karapani is not all right. It has to be given to sun and then taken. But when you give it to sun, what happens? The salt water becomes sweet water. Similarly, when we cooperate with the ISKCON society, we give the money to the accounts and then take it, it is not the same as when you yourself use the money. I'll tell you, for example, if a child is taking money from father's pocket and going to market and purchasing some chocolate and eating, is it the same as when parents are purchasing something and giving him? Is it the same or different? Big difference. That's the big difference. Why? Because the child will take the money and purchase things which are harmful to the child. Correct, no? He may buy a cocoa chocolate or he may buy a mitai which is surrounded by flies. He may buy. Whereas when parents are going to spend something for the child, they will do what is good for the child. Therefore, in our life we are allowed to enjoy, but our enjoyment should be enlightened enjoyment, sanctioned and sanctified enjoyment. Then only it is allowed. For example, you all are eating prasad. Is prasad not enjoyment? Can you say, oh Prabhuji, whenever I put gulab jamun, I don't want the sweet, I remove all the sweet. Is that what you do? We are enjoying sweet, we are enjoying dal, we are enjoying sabji, everything we are enjoying. But it is sanctioned and sanctified enjoyment which is rooted through Krishna. Otherwise we will not accept it. So it's enlightened enjoyment. In fact, this enjoyment brings enlightenment. By taking prasad which is offered to Lord first and then accepted, it purifies the mind actually. So in this way, the Lord says, vihartu kama, vihartu kama tanaha. That means Lord likes to perform pastimes along with his devotees. Like in a typical Indian home, the perverted reflection I can tell you, in a typical Indian home on Sunday you will see, you know, people get up at 8 o'clock and then they, then they read the newspaper, there is a supplement, and then the family sits together and watches the TV, and they watch some cinema movie or something at home in TV, and then afternoon they eat out, they go out to a hotel and eat. When people in a family together do activities, that gives great happiness to them, correct? But this is called, technically called sense gratification, what I am telling you now, which all conditioned souls do. But it's a perverted reflection of the Lord and his devotees wanting to come together and enjoy each other. And that enjoyment is different. Like why, for example, when you are sitting at the dining table along with your family members, do you eat or do you exchange love? Which one you do? We do both. We do both. You are also eating. Sometimes your parents tell you to eat more. They feed you, they talk about you, you talk about them. So the act of eating along with relatives and friends, it is a kind of enjoyable activity for you. Correct, no? In the same manner when people go on an outing trip. See, although mobile has got all the movies nowadays available, still theaters are there. Correct, no? Why? Because still people go with family to a movie. Otherwise you are sitting with your mobile in one room, somebody is sitting with another mobile in another room. So what gives great happiness to the living entities is actually exchanging affection with Lord and the other living entities. So therefore you will find that in material life also we seek enjoyment not alone but in company, with either office colleagues or with family members, everybody. In the same manner, the Lord also eternally has expanded himself into his Shakti, which is called Parashakti. Vishnu Shakti Para Prokta Kshetrajna Kya Tatha Para Avidya Karma Sanyaya Tritiya Shakti Rishyate. This verse from Vishnu Purana says, there is one Parashakti, which is like Radharani or Lakshmi or Sita. Vishnu Shakti Para Prokta, it's called Transcendental Shakti. And Kshetrajna Kya Tatha Para, there is one more Parashakti which is Jivas like all of us. So we are all tiny Prakriti and she is infinite Prakriti, the great Prakriti, which is Radharani, Lakshmi, Sita. So she has a ocean of love for Vishnu or Krishna or Ram, and we have a drop of love. Our drop of love is a part and parcel of Radharani's ocean of love. And our entity, our existence is, the Jiva's existence is Mamaivamsho. Jiva Loke, Jiva Bhuta, Sanatana. We are part and parcel of Krishna and our love is part and parcel of Radha's love. Is that clear to everybody? So this sentence once my spiritual master told, it just got stuck in my mind. Such a beautiful understanding. Because you know, Krishna expands himself as Radharani. And he also expands as tiny Jivas like all of us. So we are Krishna's tiny part. Because we are a very tiny part, we only have a tiny love. And Radharani is a great part because she is as good as Krishna, Radharani. Radha and Krishna are inseparable. Shakti, Shakti Matayor, Abedaha, it is said. Like Surya and Surya Kiran, and fire and heat and light. Or Kasturi and smell cannot be separated. Radha and Krishna together. So she possesses an ocean of love. Radharani herself is called abode of love. Krishna is called object of love. So the abode of love reposes love on the object of love. And when Radha and Krishna, Lakshmi Narayan, Sitaram, when their pastimes happen, all the Jivas actually are also aligned together in those pastimes. Like here you will find an interesting pastime is going to follow, which is the Samudra Mathan Leela, bringing in the Mandara Parvat, placing the Vasuki and doing the churning of the milk ocean. And then Lord Vishnu will also be available for them. Whenever they face difficulty, they can depend on the Lord, take help, and then the project will be done. Similarly, in families also, the joy comes when you depend on each other. In a family, when there is a crisis, then all the relatives, they forget the quarrel and come together. In that, then depending on each other, they see each other's sacrifice and the affection increases by that. In the same manner, in Lord's pastimes also, you will find the affection for the Lord will increase when the Lord performs such pastimes. So it's called vihattu kamaha. Vihattu kamasthanaha samudron matanadivihi, it is said. So surakadiye sureshwaraha. He was capable of performing all the activities of demigod single-handedly. But why did he involve them? Because he wanted to enjoy fun. Just like sometimes the parents tell a boy or a daughter or son, "Beta, I want to do gardening. Can you please help me?" And the kid may ask, "What do you want me to do?" "Please kindly come, you pluck this grasses here. You know, then you fetch the water from there. You know, place the seeds here." As if, they can't do it themselves. But they actually want to train the child. They involve the child. Similarly, Krishna or Rama or Vishnu, they also involve the jivas to increase the happiness. Imagine if Lord Rama told all the monkeys, "Hey monkeys, don't worry about Sita. I am present in the heart of Ravana as a super soul. I can just cause some artery to be blocked. And I will cause a massive heart attack. And poor Ravana will fall to the ground, dropping dead. And then I will fetch Sita on my own. I am, after all, God, mind you. I don't depend on you." And then all the monkeys would say, "But sir, what are we supposed to do? What do you want us to do?" Lord says, "Just clap hands, that's all." Do you think monkeys will be happy with Ram? Their hands are itching for a war. Their hands are itching to do some Setubandha or something. So Lord Ram behaves as if he is dependent on the Vanaras. He's telling the Vanaras, "Oh Vanaras, can you all help me? How will I cross this massive ocean? Can you please help me to build the Setubandha? Can you please help me find Sita?" Lord pretends as if he is dependent on them. But that dependence increases the love between Ram and the Vanaras. Similarly, the Lord also here is going to increase happiness of himself, happiness of all the demigods, all the jivas, by this pastime. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Hanta Brahmanaho Shambho He Deva Mama Bhashitam Shrinuta Vahita Sarve Shreyo Vahsyat Yatha Suraha. Yeah?
The Supreme Personality of God had said, "O Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva and other demigods, please hear me with great attention, for what I say will bring good fortune for all of you."
Yeah, shreyo vaha syat yatha suraha. Lord is telling Brahma, Shiva and all the devatas, "I am going to give you some instructions, listen attentively, and if you follow them, you will attain all good fortune." Similarly for us, anybody who is of a spiritual mentor or a spiritual master, when sometimes people are very fond of asking questions, but they are not equally fond of noting down the answers. They are only curious to ask more and more and more questions. One devotee used to ask so many questions. One preacher commented, "You are a Prashna Sagar." He said, you may ask so many questions. But when we ask questions, when the answers come out from Guru, one should actually be very attentive. One should have an open mind and attentive ear. If my mind is not open, I may think that I will partially follow it. "Oh, this is too much. I don't know why did I ask this question. I should not have asked." Like that people think. Their mind is not open. Heart is not open. Or mind and heart may be open, but they are not attentive. They are looking at the watch. They are thinking, "Oh, I have to do this work. I have to do that work." So both these things are required. Open mind and attentive ear. For listening to the good instructions. And also one should make a note, one should actually worship the instructions. One should actually very carefully, attentively to follow the instructions. So the Lord is saying in the next verse, "As long as you are not flourishing, you should make a truce with the demons and asuras. who are now being favored by time. And then he's telling. So in this way, Lord will tell them that now you are all wanting to get your kingdom back. You should follow the logic of the snake and the mouse, he's saying. What is this logic? Once the snake and the mouse were caught in inside a tokri, inside a basket, which was kept upside down. So they both couldn't come out. So generally the snake likes to eat mouse. But this time the snake didn't eat the mouse. He thought, maybe if I can take help of the mouse to make a hole. So then he took the help of the mouse to make a hole. After the hole was made, he ate the mouse. And then he escaped from the hole. So he got eatable also and he got escape also. Correct, no? Both he got. So this is the principle. He is saying that it's called Ahi Mushikavat. He's calling it. Ahi means snake, Mushika means the mouse. So what the Lord is telling, see, you alone cannot regain your kingdom. You can. It's not possible for you. Right now, demons are more powerful. They are worshipping their guru. Who is their guru? They have worshipped their guru and they have become very powerful. So this also teaches us one lesson. Anybody who faithfully follows the guru's instruction becomes very empowered. Like Prabhupada disciples are doing miracles all over the globe. They are touching the lives of hundreds and thousands and lakhs of people. How? Because they have become blessed. So you can achieve more things in life through blessing than by our own tiny effort. Both gurus, one side there is Shukracharya for the demons, another side there is Brihaspati for the demigods. Demigods displeased Brihaspati and they lost all their opulences, they became bereft of opulences, they became ugly, they became like a penniless beggars. On the other hand, Asuras worshipped Shukracharya very well and Shukracharya became pleased with them, he blessed them. And now not only Asuras are flourishing, they took over the kingdom of the devatas. So now Asuras have occupied the whole universe practically. Now the devatas are roaming around here and there, helter-skelter. They have no place to go. The Lord told, see, one good thing about devatas, the devatas are not people who want to usurp Asuras' property. Whenever devatas are going and crying to Vishnu, what do they want? They want back their own property, that's all. Therefore, devatas are good in that sense. They are not going and occupying Asura's area and say, hey, Asura's, get out now. They don't do that. But the Asura's have a tendency to have their own place plus occupy devata's property also. Like Duryodhana. Duryodhana wanted to be king of the world. He wanted to occupy all the place of the Pandavas. Ultimately, was destroyed. Ravana wanted to have his Lanka, but he wanted to enjoy so many other men's wives and he was destroyed. You can see that. Very Asuric mentality. Asuric mentality means against Lord Vishnu. So even when Aditi prayed for Vamanadev to come, she actually told, we don't want Asura's property. What do we want? Please tell the Asura's to give back my son's property. That's all. Just like sometimes when two children are playing, mother or father have given them some toys, but some children are naughty. They take away the toys of all other children and tell them, get lost. You've seen that? Like that, Asura's are like that. But good children, what they say? Hey, I will have my toy, you have your toy. Recently, I was giving a lecture to our BMS children. They are not very small children. They are all in 7th or 8th standard. So I asked the question, if you all are getting into train, where will you sit? I asked. So naturally, initially everybody said, we all would like to sit in the window seat. But there is only 2 window seats, but you are 8 children, what you will do? So one boy was telling that, Prabhu, I will ask all others that, how many of you like to sit near the window? No, most of the people like, correct, no? They like the window seat. So then he said, then I will take turns. I will put another person there for half an hour, then a third person, then I'll again go and sit, which means a sharing heart. There's a tendency to share. So that type of sharing nature should be taught right from the beginning. A jiva actually has the nature to share. So we should not keep everything for oneself selfishly. Like imagine you are going to Mayapur, you got a big Mayapur cake, you know, round cake like a full moon. So what can you do with the cake? Every day you can eat little bit, correct, keep in the bureau and eat little every day. You can finish it in 1 week or so. Or you can call the devotees and distribute to them. Have you seen the crows? If one crow's life is in danger, in electric wire or something, they will say, ka, 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 they will call all the crows. You've seen that? Similarly, if one crow finds some food, he will call all the crows. Hey, here is food, come, let's share. You'll see that. So two natures you can learn from a crow. One is, if somebody is in danger, actually one should immediately come running to help. The whole community should come to help. Similarly, if we get something, we should be in a sharing mood with others. Not in a usurping mood for oneself, or selfish mood for oneself. But generally generally the demons are very selfish. That is the nature. I heard a story. Once upon a time, one farmer had a bull, a pig, and a cock. All three were living in his farmhouse. So one day, besides these three, there was also a rat roaming around in the house. You know, he would get the eatables, he would cut the clothes and all that. So the farmer brought not a rat trap. You know, they used to have a steel wire kind of thing. It will just hit the rat. You know that? There's one kind of, it's not rat trap, it's rat catch, I think. Rat catcher. It catches the rat. So he brought one rat catcher and put it there. So suddenly the rat noticed it. My Lord, this is very dangerous for me. In the dark of the night, if I put my foot over this, immediately it will kill me. On the spot, I'll be finished. So immediately he ran to the pig and said, hey pig, there's a danger for me, you know. And pig said, what is that? He said, this is it. And pig laughed and said, see, I will never be caught by that. Because it is very small. So if you have trouble, you know, why are you coming and troubling me? That's your problem, not mine, he said. Then he went to the cock and said, hey cock, can you help me? You know, how do I get rid of this? Or give me some clue, some guidance I want. What should I do? Cock said, you don't bother about it. You just live peacefully. Don't fear. Nothing will happen. But you see, in the night time, what is night? What is day? Why do you bother? You know? And the cock said, we have never heard any story from our ancestors that any cock was caught in this. So he at least concerned, you know, just forget about it, he said. So he was not giving any solution to him. Then he went to the bull. And the bull heard the rat's story. He also laughed off. He said, see, the problem is you are very tiny. See, I am such a big bull. I have no fear. So everybody thought about whom? Themselves. They were all very selfish. Then what happened? One night, suddenly, in the dark night, sound came. Cut! Sound came like that. Then the farmer's wife understood, oh, now the rat is finished. She wanted to put on the light and see. Before she could reach the switch, she went near that rat catcher. A snake was caught in that. Snake's tail was caught. So as soon as she came near and put her feet on the tail and the body of the snake hit her, cut. Immediately it gave her a bite. She screamed loud and light was put on and farmer got up. Then she became bedridden and got a very high fever and doctor was brought and everything. So a lot of relatives came. Then the man told immediately, cut the murgi, cut the cock and cook, because people have come to see my wife. He thought 3 days she will have fever. But then the cock was cut and the fever continued for one more week. Now relatives did not go away, those who came. They wanted to see that she is completely well. In villages you will see sometimes people throw away everything else and come, you know. A lot of people were there. Then he told, cut the pig also. They cut the pig and fed a feast also with everybody. Then at last after 10-12 days she died, that lady died. Then big amount of relatives came. Then he cut the bull also. And the rat was running around watching what is happening. See, the problem was whose problem in the beginning? Ash problem. And he survived and all the other three fellows were gone. Because they were living in the same community, but they were not concerned about the rat. So they were ignoring the rat. Finally, the rat's problem became whose problem? Their own problem. So in this way, you will see that demons by nature are selfish like this. They only think about themselves. Therefore, the Lord said, I will make a plan for you by which you can surely get your kingdom back. Nothing to worry. But you just have to follow me, the Lord said. And then the Lord is telling in the 21st verse, immediately endeavor to produce nectar, which a person, how to produce nectar? In the 22-23 he is telling, O demigod, cast into the ocean of milk all kinds of vegetables, grass, creepers, drugs. Then with my help, making Mandara mountain, the churning rod, and Vasuki, the rope for churning, churn the ocean of milk with undiverted attention. Thus the demons will be engaged in labor, but you demigods will gain the actual result, the nectar. So you will get the nectar, he says. So now from 24th verse onwards, I will take it ahead in the next sitting, because very important instructions Lord Vishnu is going to give, which you should not hear at the fag end of the lecture. You should hear in the beginning of the lecture, so I will do it in the next class. And so in this pastime, I will not talk about Lakshmi, Rama, garlanding Vishnu, because I took an exclusive session on that before. In the previous two sessions, we devoted time for that. So in this way, I will highlight certain sections of the pastime. When you come next time, Vishnu's instruction to demigods and how they faithfully followed it. We will begin from that. Srila Prabhupada ki, Bhakta Vrinda ki, thank you very much.